Hello, here we are in West Hampstead at the bottom of Fortune Green Road. Fortune Green is a little park just up the road there. And we're going to catch the 139 bus from where it starts here in West Hampstead. At that bus stop. So I was walking down there and the fire engines seem to be doing something, but it looks like it's just some sort of practice or something, because they didn't go zooming off. So, okay, I'm waiting for the bus. Can't quite see if the driver's in it yet. I think he is. Yeah, there are signs of movement there. Oh, here we go. He got in there eventually. They hang around there for a while and then they come along. The 139 goes from West Hampstead to Waterloo. I've chosen this bus route because basically it passes quite a lot of sites. Managed to get a seat at the front, otherwise I would have had to wait for the next one. Bit difficult. Well, you need a seat at the front to do this, what I'm doing. But West Hampstead is one of the sort of middle class parts of London, so it's a little bit more upscale than many areas. It's not as posh as Hampstead itself, but it's not bad. It's quite pleasant, a student-y sort of place, really. Westfield College used to be up here. I don't know if it's still Westfield College or what, but I have a feeling it was sold off by the University of London. And while we travel on the journey, I'm going to talk about odds and ends that occur to me. Dressing for success, the Anthropocene Epoch, and spacey things. Alien life and other planets and stuff of that sort. See the big old mansion block on the right there? That's the kind of housing you get in a lot of London. They're generally sort of fairly luxurious apartments. And of course fairly expensive. That's the Thames Link railway station, which goes into town as well. And up on the top of this little hill here, we have on the right a tube station. And indeed on the left, a little bit further down, there is another tube station. They are on different lines. They don't all join together. It's a bit of a pain, basically. You have to come out in the rain and walk from one to the other. It's usually raining in Britain, so just expect it. It wasn't today, and that's why I thought it was a good day to make the video. We've had quite a good summer, 2016, but that's exceptional. Yeah, the dressing for success thing, it came to my mind because there was a story in the papers about somebody suing their company, or at least complaining about it. I think they sued them because they didn't get a promotion. And when they found out the reason, it was because they were wearing brown shoes. This guy, it was some banking or finance company, okay. And he was wearing brown shoes instead of black shoes. And I guess the company felt he didn't quite look professional enough. And although these rules are silly, I kind of agree with the company. There's no excuse for not knowing what the dress code is, really. The thing is, humans are we're kind of silly monkeys or apes, basically, and we are impressed by things with, like, clothing. It has a sort of magical effect on us. It's one of the little triggers of our psychology. If somebody is dressed sharp, we up our estimation of them. There are some reasons for it. I mean, in the animal kingdom, if someone has a really plush plumage, you know that they are fit and well. And in the human world, if someone is wearing sharp clothes, you know they've got some money, which is another way of measuring whether they are fit and well. At least they're fit, at least, you know, socially. And in companies, especially banks, finance companies, legal firms, this sort of thing, they, certainly the top people, will dress super sharp with expensive clothing. I mean, you can mimic it with cheaper clothing, but it's visible. And they have these rules, basically, to help their company make its impression upon impressionable clients, of course. And in fact, it applies to some extent in almost any company, really. If you dress a little bit sharper than your rivals, you will up yourself in the higher up's estimations. It shows that you've got some brain, right? It shows also that you are a willing worker, willing to conform to the rules and be a good wage slave. But it also shows some leadership potential, because leaders dress to impress. They dress to impress their subordinates and their customers. And it works, right? It just works, because humans, as I say, are silly monkeys, and these things impress us. So, if you want to get on, as well as actually learning job-related skills, learn these social skills as well. Best book, I'll put a link to it, is John T. Malloy's Dress for Success. Look at this building place by on the left here, by the way. These are apartments. It's bizarre 1960s type thing, but look at it. Very strange. And another one. It's really nice sometimes when they have flowers cascading down the side of it in the spring. So yes, black shoes make you look sharper. The reason for these rules, as I say, is to impress people, and the rules are designed by the actual upper classes. The Eton set over here, the Hamptonites in the USA, and there's every country has its sort of influential upper class set. Because we are hierarchical beings, and we look up to our leaders, and the leaders know how to manipulate us, and do. And it helps you if you know what they're doing. It helps you to be immune to it, or to at least take it with a pinch of salt, if you can do it too. Obviously, you don't overdress in some small business. You don't want to scare your own boss. That could work against you. But you should be knowing how to dress for an interview, for example, and things of this sort. It does show some nous. So, if you want to know the rules, get the book. That, by the way, is the Abbey Road crossing where the Beatles did their famous picture on their album of the same name. And just on the right here is Abbey Road Studios, behind all this building work at the moment. And you see a crowd of people there waiting to photograph themselves on the crossing. It's like this all day, every day. People photographing themselves on that crossing, which is just an ordinary zebra crossing, right? But the Beatles made it famous, so there you go. I don't think I have a photo of myself on it. We're passing this edge of Maida Vale at the moment, I think. Or St John's Wood anyway, it's this sort of area, the posh part of London, poshish. More apartment blocks. Big, big mansion block places. I mean, the dressing also includes how you do up your tie. I see so many people who wear a tie, but they're using a crummy knot, which is not symmetrical, or it's a bit loose around the neck, or the length is wrong, and it's hanging down too far, or it's up too short, or the rear piece is sticking out. All these little details show whether you're a klutz or not, basically. To people who are interested in that sort of thing. I mean, you can use it to show a sort of rebellion and independence. Everything we do with clothing is showing something, right? And even if it's unintentional, it's often subconsciously intentional. People who dress scruffily are showing a certain lack of self-respect sometimes, or they're showing that they're a bit of a rebel and they do respect themselves. It depends how they carry it and how they carry themselves. But a tie, gentlemen, should have a symmetrical Windsor knot, and it should reach down to your belt. It should not be above the belt or below the belt. It should reach the belt, okay? If it's more than a couple of inches off, it looks bad. So there. Now we're passing the Regent's Canal here. Can't see it, of course. But if you're walking along it, you'll come out here along this path, probably. And you'll have to cross this road to get to the other bit. Sometimes you can walk along the canal all the way, but they've sort of partitioned part of it off because people live there and they don't want tourists looking in their boats all the time, I suppose. There's one entrance for the residents, and to the right of this, about 50 metres down, is another entrance which you can walk down. It's open to the public, so you can walk down the right-hand side of the canal if you're going from right to left on this view. It's just by this crossing here, I think. Yeah, somewhere there it is. You can go down there. I have another video of the Regent's Canal walk which you can look at your leisure. Coming up on the right, where that yellow and red sign is Church Street Market. I've seen this market in tourist guides and stuff, but honestly it's not worth visiting. It's rubbish, in my view. It's just an ordinary street market where you buy washing up liquid and some basic groceries. There's nothing special about it whatsoever. I wouldn't waste your time. Go and visit Buckingham Palace or something, you know. There's plenty to see without coming here to buy soap. All right. I think the market isn't on today, but
Rossmore Road, Listen Grove, a light here for the
We are going to turn left, and we're heading towards Regent's Park and Baker Street. It was a nice sunny day today, on this day, although it's kind of washed out for the camera. It couldn't. There were clouds and blue skies, but it's sort of come out a bit white on the camera, because it never knows how to expose things. The cameras don't have the sort of range of brightness that the human eye can see, so I've exposed this for the actual buildings and stuff, so you can see what's there. Otherwise it will all be too dark. But I was thinking about, you know, global warming, whether it's caused by humans or not. Actually science says it is caused by humans, and personally I believe it, even though there are doubts about, you know, some of the detail. There is enough evidence that stuff is happening. We should be going into an ice age, not going into warmer periods. We're at the end of the Holocene interglacial, and geologists are proposing a new era called the Anthropocene, because anthropoids, i.e. humans, and, well, apes are anthropoids too, but what they mean are humans, right? This is Park Road, by the way. Regent's Park is on the left. Well worth a visit. I have made a video of this, but I haven't published it yet. I need to do some narration or chit-chat, but there's the entrance, or an entrance. I think it's York Gate, if I remember rightly. Into the park. It's one of the big London parks. Nice place to stroll around. You can spend a few hours there, and some really expensive accommodation in there too, if you want. For millionaires, basically. And that is Baker Street, just ahead to the right. And on the right is the Sherlock Holmes Museum, which is a shop. But there it is. And this is Baker Street Underground Station. Baker Street, made famous, I suppose, by that old Jerry Rafferty song, which was a hit when I was at college in London. So it makes me a little bit nostalgic when I hear it. The days when I thought I might earn a load of money and get rich quick and stuff like that. How wrong was I? But anyway. This is the Marylebone Road up ahead. Or Marylebone, but Marylebone it's pronounced. Now, as the bus moves off on the right, you will see ahead on the right, you will see a greenish building, I think, if the camera can wake up. Here we go. Which is Madame Tussauds. There it is, that dome. The Waxworks Museum and shop, basically. Tourist trap. But fun to visit. And they have an astronomy bit in there as well. Anyway, what geologists are talking about is terminating the Holocene era and inventing a new epoch called the Anthropocene. The Holocene began around 9700 BC, or BCE, before the current era, as people like to say these days. But because humans have been dumping plutonium into the earth from atom bomb explosions and tests, and carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, of course, and plastics in particular, it effectively represents a new geological era. That building, by the way, the glassy one, is the headquarters of Marks and Spencer's supermarket. I'm not quite sure what this building is, but the glassy one to the left is Marks and Sparks. To me, that the Anthropocene era represents the fact that the geological record is showing signs of an incipient Type 1 civilization. we're starting to affect the whole planet, basically. That hasn't happened since creatures back 600 million years or more ago, in fact 3 billion or so, began pumping oxygen into the atmosphere and ruining it for the anaerobic life forms that existed before. This is Manchester Square. I think. Or Portman Square. And on the left, if we look carefully, there is a spy shop where you can buy like hidden camera pens and I don't know. Stuff to spy on. People, plug sockets to stick in the wall to spy on people. I think you get a little submarine and stuff in there as well. It's kind of weird. Where is it? There it is. Outside Selfridges, the big department store on Oxford Street. We're still on Baker Street, but we turn the corner and we'll be on Oxford Street then. And there's a Marks and Spencer shop. And that's Selfridges. By the way, there was news about people thinking they caught some anomalous signal from a star. Was it aliens or what? Oxford Street here, by the way. Well, it turns out it's an old Russian satellite that everybody had forgotten about. Here's Selfridges with its interesting displays. This is a shop that makes plenty of money. On the busiest shopping street in the country. Can hardly go wrong. That's Duke Street, where Duchess of Duke Street story is presumably set. Now we're just approaching Bond Street and New Bond Street. There's Bond Street tube station. Bond and New Bond Street are down there. There they go. One of them. HMV shop. Still surviving. They keep closing shops and struggling and I don't know what, but they're still just about around. Debenhams, a struggling department store. House of Fraser. There was another story over the last couple of weeks of a star that shows some unusual dimming. It's called Tabby's Star. It's about 1,500 light years away. And this, by the way, up ahead, this junction is Oxford Circus, which used to be a roundabout, presumably, why it's called Circus. And you can see it's got this historical round structure in the middle, because people can now cross all the way across, which they didn't used to be able to do. It's super packed sometimes. This was fairly early in the morning. Quiet, you know, Sunday. But we're going to turn right here down Regent Street. Now the thing about Tabby's Star is it's been dimming for about 100 years. And it's been observed for longer than that. But, and it did dim for a while in 1889 or something like that as well. But other than that, it appears to be an F-type main sequence star, and such stars do not dim. So there's been speculation. Could it be a Dyson sphere? Could it be a Type 2 civilization that's shielding off the star to absorb the energy? They've got big solar panels up there, or they're building a spherical planet around it or something, or a ring at least. Because F-type stars don't dim. However, there's been another such star discovered, and that one is only 11 million years old, estimate. So, Regent Street, by the way, is posh. That's Liberty's, another super expensive department store. Regent Street is, of course, owned by the Crown. That is super expensive, but interesting. It's got all these designer clothes shops and so on. If you're into fashion, you know, you probably would want to go here. At least look. The second star being so young makes astronomers wonder if this first star, Tabby Star, is actually younger than they think. Because young F-type stars do change in brightness because they haven't really stabilised yet into their main sequence behaviour, where they are just pretty much stable for billions of years. You see, if it wasn't a Dyson sphere or an unusual star in it, like it just naturally, an early F-type perhaps, then, for example, one theory was that it was comets blocking our view. However, trouble with comets is, that's Air Street down that little alley, trouble with comets is that it would require 648,000 of them all to be passing in front of the star in the last century and not at other times. Which would be very strange because, you know, things in space arrange themselves in rings and stuff like that. Another thought is that maybe we're looking at a ring of debris, but edge on. Piccadilly Circus, you've got Eros there. On the left is the Trocadero Centre, that is Charing Cross Road, Theatreland. The Trocadero, or that is the Palladium rather, London Palladium. I like this statue here. Leicester Square down there. We're now on, I forget the name of this road. Begins with an H, I think. But whatever it is, we're on it. Something to do with hay. Haymarket, that's it. Planet Hollywood. Scruffy looking cinema, needs cleaning. Got the theatre there. I forget which one, is it Her Majesty's? Got that. And we're coming up to Trafalgar Square. That's the National Gallery up ahead. We're going to come in at the bottom end. As the Bishop said to the Bishop, there's Canadian Embassy. If you look ahead to the right, you'll see some of the famous lions of Trafalgar Square. There we go. Dead ahead, the statue of King Charles, beheaded by Oliver Cromwell during the Glorious Revolution. There we have Duke of Wellington. Or Nelson, Admiral Nelson, or somebody like that, you know, the guy. It's Nelson, isn't it? The lions. They're getting ready to have some concert here in the square. St Martin in the Fields Church. The National Gallery. Can't show you all the stuff here, there's actually more to see. There's Pall Mall sort of behind. There's Parliament down there. See Big Ben in the distance. The Strand up ahead, and then we're going up beside Trafalgar Square. South African Embassy dead ahead, with a springbok in the front there. And you've got the National Gallery and the National Portrait Gallery on the left. You've got the National Opera with the globe thing on top. This is St Martin in the Fields Church. The Royal Opera House, I think it is, or something like that, up there with the globe on top of it. Colosseum or something, I don't know. Up ahead, Charing Cross Station. And that little tower in front was, for many centuries, the official centre of London, or at least of Westminster, but of London as a whole. The actual geographical centre now, as London's grown, has moved not very far from here, but it's on the riverside. And this is the Strand again. Again, there are theatres here. Covent Garden is kind of up on the left behind all these buildings, a block or two away. Zimbabwe Embassy, I think, is around here somewhere. Looking a bit forlorn. Kinky Boots. One of the shows on at the moment. Hobson's Choice, the Vaudeville Theatre. Stanley Gibbons, if you're into stamp collecting. Their official shop. My Fair Lady there. Oh, Funny Girl. No. Yeah, Funny Girl. I remember seeing the Barbara Streisand movie. That's at the Savoy Theatre. I would go to the theatre sometimes, but it's just so expensive. It's, you know, if you're on holiday, you've got to do this sort of thing. But if you live here, I think, you know, I could have 20 meals for the price of a ticket. What am I going to do? St Clement Danes Church up ahead in the distance. That appears in detail on my Fleet Street video. We got stuck in traffic here for a bit, so I paused the camera. But this is an interesting clock, I think. Now we are going to go off the Strand, helicopter up above the church, well, past it, I suppose. We're going to go right here across Waterloo Bridge, and the sights here are pretty cool. Talk about life on other worlds and stuff. Some scientists are proposing exogenesis, where we send robot probes to other planets, or to other planets elsewhere in the nearby universe, and populate them with our own genetics, that is, biological life. They would go to new planets. That's Somerset House, an art gallery and so on. Here's the bridge. The South Bank complex there. City of London in the distance, St Paul's Cathedral, the walkie-talkie tower, Royal Festival Hall on the left, London Eye in the middle, Houses of Parliament on the right. National Theatre down there, sort of Shakespeare-y stuff. IMAX cinema up ahead, and Waterloo Station is behind, sort of, and on the right here. We're near the end of the journey now. As for these scientists populating other planets, uninhabited ones, it's maybe a good idea for the long, long, long term, but I think we should terraform Venus and Mars first, make them inhabitable by us. I'm pretty sure we will, if we survive. We're coming to the end of the journey now. It stops outside Waterloo Station, or very near it. There's the station, Waterloo Station, up ahead. The building in the background. Hope you've enjoyed the bus ride. It wasn't very long, 36 and a half minutes, not bad. Plus a bit where I paused the video, call it about 40 minutes, something like that. From West Hampstead to Waterloo. Okay, bye for now.